Hello and welcome. My name is Panos Kalaragiannis. I'm a System Security Engineer and a Linux Distribution Developer. Thank you for joining in this session. This technical talk will focus on Linux administration and Linux security. Security is very important nowadays because there are many vulnerabilities, many data breaches and malwares. Not only malwares, there are ransomwares too. How can we secure a system? We need to update the system properly. We have to understand how to update a system, update the kernel version, update the packages, and to manage the repositories. In addition, we need to manage the system services, like which services are active, which daemons are active, which open ports are listening, and which are closed. We can, of course, perform a scan to our system with vulnerability auditing tools like OpenVAS, like RMAP. We will see them later on. We can use PAM, pluggable authentication modules. We can set a limit on a user's processes. We can monitor processes, which ones belong to a specific user, and of course we can automate everything with BAS. We can automate the process with BAS, and we can execute it daily or monthly with the help of the cron tab. So let's move on. These are the topics that I will cover. First of all is the user management. I will explain to you how to create a user, how to delete a user, how to set a password, how to set a secure password, to set the home directory to the user. I will show you how to monitor your processes with a bunch of tools, command line tools, because you could have a server edition and you could not have a desktop environment, so text tools are very important to administration. I will show you how to update a system, either it is Debian or Red Hat or CentOS. How to manage repositories, what are they, which are stable, which are unstable, how to perform a scan, a vulnerability scan with OpenVAS, like I mentioned before. I will show you how to set PAM modules, I will explain them later, and how to write scripts, like how to make a backup script, how to make a vulnerability scanning script. We will see them later on. Okay, let's start. First of all, we have the Linux user management. I will show you how to create a user, how to delete a user, and how to set a password for the user. I will show you how to modify user, so a user can access some system resources or access some services. He will be in a group that can access some resources. I will explain to you what is the password, the shadow, the group file in etc directory, and finally how to disable that account. Okay, let's start with user add, user del and password command. It's for user creation, user deletion, and set the password accordingly. For this purpose, I will use a virtual machine. I will use Kali, derivative of Debian, so you can see practical examples of what I'm doing. So let's begin. Okay, to create a user, we will type the user add command. Sudo user add, following by the user. I will name him user user array. Okay, we can add the -m to create a home directory for the user array. Okay, we can set a password for the user. To do this, we can simply use the password command for link with the username. Okay, you can use a very powerful password, so it will be difficult for an attacker to crack this password. You can use a passphrase, a 12 or more character password full of capital letters, numbers and symbols. We'll use a simple one just to demonstrate this faster, and let's try to login with the user so we can ensure that everything is under control. Fine. PWD, we are in the home directory of the user A. Let's see an example how to delete a user. We will create a user, another user, because we will use user A for some examples. So user add user B. Okay, and to delete this user we can type user dash B for the second user we want to delete. Okay, that's a user add, user del and password command. Let's see what's next. Next is the user mod command, which we can modify user. As I told you before, we can set the user so he can access some system resources. Let's see some examples. Okay, so user A. Okay, PWD, we are there in the home directory of the user A. Let's create a file with root privileges. Okay, why not? We can do this with touch command, example1.txt. Okay, the password for the root, for the sudo password. Okay, we can clearly see that the username is not in the sudoers. That's why we want to use the user mod command. We can add the user array to the sudoers right now. Not only the sudoers, we can add the user to another group like Wireshark, so he can capture packets and many more examples. Okay, sudo user mod dash a. I will explain to you what all of those do. Sudo user A. Okay, with this command the user A here is appended to a group which one is sudo with user all, with user mode, so we added the user A to the sudo. Let's switch back to the user A. Fine, user. Let's try now to create an example1.txt with sudo privileges user. Okay, as we can see, we can create the example1 with sudo privileges because the user A can access the sudoers. Fine. Okay, let's see another example of the user mod command. Okay, we can change the home directory of the user A. So to do this, we type user mod D for the new home directory. The previous one, as you saw, is the home slash user A. right now will be OPT. Why not? User A. Okay, so when we will log in to the user A, user, let's see, where are we? Okay, we are in the OPT file, OPT directory, because we changed the home directory of the user A to OPT. Okay, let's clear the screen. Let's see what's next. All right. Let's see what is the purpose of the password file in etc directory. Let's change back to the Kali machine and output the contents of etc password. Okay. Right here you can see a plenty information. Like you can see users, you can see numbers, you can see shell. So what are those? Okay, let's begin. Here is the user. Here is the user A, the user that we had created before. Here is the password, but the password is moved to etc shadow file. Don't worry, we will explain it later. Here is the user ID. Every user has a specific user ID, just know. Here's the group ID. Here is some information about the user. For example, we could write for user A, here's a test user. Okay, here's a test user. Here's the home directory of the user. And here is the default cell. As you can see, my main user Panos has the user ID of 1001. The group ID of 1001 has the home directory as home panels, and the default cell is the ZSH. Okay, that's all about the etc password file. Let's continue to see what's next.
So let's see which is the purpose of the shadow file in the etc directory. As I told you before, as I mentioned before, passwords were moved from the etc password file to the etc shadow file. The shadow file contains the passwords of the users or of the system users in an encrypted form inside this file. So let's see more about it. Okay, here I have printed out the shadow file in the etc directory. As you can see, this is a user root, there are system users, as I mentioned before, other system users, and here's my user Panos. This will be the example for this section, for the etc shadow file explanation. So let's begin. As you can see, as in the etc password file, there are semicolons between values. Okay, we will explain those values as well. So let's begin. Panos here, the first one is the username, so it's something easy. It will be your user, your username. Secondly, we have our password, which is encrypted. As you can see, the sign rate here is the encryption method. In my case, is the SHA 512. It's a cryptographic algorithm. There are many cryptographic algorithms. You can search them online. You should see a $1 in your shadow file, which means that your password is encrypted in MD5. MD5 is another cryptographic algorithm. Some others is the Blowfish. Blowfish belongs to $2A, and another version of Blowfish to $2. why, and there are another cryptographic algorithm in the etc shadow file, which is a $5, which is the SHA-256. So there are other cryptographic algorithms which they are very very powerful. They can do many things. They can do they can encrypt your password with some keys. So let's move to this value between the password and the zero. It's the last password change since 1st January of 1970. So as you can see, it counts the days that the password is changed from then. This zero here is the maximum days, the minimum days required for between the password changes. It does not require any password changes between some days. Here is the maximum days that the password is valid. So as you can see, our password is valid forever. It's an extremely big amount of days that our password is valid, and here we have the number of days that the our password is going to expire, and a warn will be sent to our user. We don't have to worry because our password, as we can see, will not require. But in case you set some security modules and you set the password to expire, you have to change the value because you can manage the days that the warn message will be sent to the user. Okay, we have some blank values here, so we could change them. The first one is the number of days that the password is expired and the account is disabled, and the last one is the days since 1st January of 1970 that the account is disabled. So that's all about the etc shadow file. Let's see what's next.
Okay, let's see what is the purpose, which is the purpose of the etc group file. Let's switch back to the Kali machine. Let's output its content. Okay, as before, you can see users, system users, semicolons, etc. So let's see. Here's the user array, here's the user panos, here's the password, but it is blank because here you can use privileged groups. Here's the group ID, and here is a list of users that contained in a group. Let's see, for example, the group sudo. Okay, here you can see that in the group sudo, the group sudo contains the user Kali, the user panos, and the user A. Okay, that's all the group, the etc group file. Let's switch back to our presentation to see what's next. Okay, the next one is how to disable the root account. This is a very important section, because to increase the security level, you should lock the root account. You should use a user account with root privileges, so an attacker cannot enter with root account. Okay, let's see how it's done. To do this, we can simply change the default cell of the user in etc password. That's why I explained to you this file. So we can use a text editor like Vim or Nano. I will use Nano. Okay, I'm sorry. Yep. Fine. Here's the user root, which has the default cell bash, and we will change it to sbin. In sbin there are all the root software, the root system built-in commands, and as a default shell we will use no login. Okay, let's save it. Fine. Let's login as root. Okay, as you can see, this account is currently not available. We have managed to lock the account. To revert it, simply we can use again a default cell like bin bash. Let's save it. Let's login as root. As you can see, we can login as root again. Exit, clear, and let's see what's next. Alright, here we have the Linux process monitoring. Linux process monitoring is very important in Linux administration and Linux security. It is one of the most important tasks of a system administrator in general, because behind every user there are many processes, so it's very important to monitor everything about this. Let's start. What is a process? A process refers to a program in execution. It's a running instance of a program. For example, when we open Firefox, a new process is created. When we open a terminal, a new process is created, and so on. Also, there are two types of processes. There are the foreground and the background processes. Foreground processes are the interactive ones, where we can control them. For example, Firefox or Thunderbird or VirtualBox is an interactive process. It's a foreground process. Background processes are the non-interactive ones. They are running in the background. They usually are started in the boot, in the system boot, so they are controlled by the init process, like the systemd, and many other services, for example sshd, and many other processes that are running in the background. So how we can monitor processes? There are many tools, there are many terminal tools, so let's take a look on some. Here's a list that I have prepared to explain. First of all is the PS, so let's start with PS. I will change back to the Kali machine. Okay, let's type PS. Okay, as we can see, here are the processes that are running in my terminal, so it's the Z cell and the PS command. We can type PS-A to see all the active processes. As you can see, there are many of those. Systemd. We can see. Let's see about K-worker. We can see Xorg about our desktop environment. We can see LightDM, And as we can see, those are the open the active processes like Apache, Zcel, and many other. Another example is the ps dot, let's clear the screen, ps.x. Here will be will output all the processes that belongs to our user, which is Kali right now. So sorry, it's small x. Sorry. Okay. As we can see, every process here is running by our user, Kali. Let's see another example. Here with this psfg, for example, we can type the Tor service, the Tor network, which anonymizes our traffic, Debian Tor. Okay, here's to list all processes for the group and the group name, which is Debian Tor. We can see the process user green Tor, etc. In this UID and this PID. Okay, another useful example and another valuable example is the PS e forest, which will output all the active processes, but it will output all the linked process to its parent. Okay, as you can see, here we have the XFC4 panel, which is a child process of the Xorg of the LIDM, which is a process of the LIDM service. Okay, those are the examples. Here's the Apache 2 of the service Apache 2. Okay, and we can see how to list the performance of the system, which process consumes the memory or which process consumes the CPU. So how to see about the formats, how to see about memory, about CPU. As we can see, here's the user, here's the PID, here's the CPU consumption, the memory consumption, and the command, which is the process command. And let's see how we can see about memory and CPU consumption. Okay, right here you can see all the parameters that that you can use in the output. There are many useful outputs. Here's the CPU, here's the memory that we are going to test. So let's clear the screen. So let's output everything. Okay. Sorry. No. CMD. Memory. CPU. And let's sort it out by, let's begin with memory. Okay. As we can see, every process with this PID, with this command, and the memory consumption, let's output the first five. This will be done with the help of the head command, and the number we want the first five, so head n for number 5. Okay, we can see the first 10 processes by the most CPU consumption, so let's change it to CPU. Okay, let's clear the screen. Okay, here are the first 10 processes which have the most to list CPU consumption. Okay, let's clear the screen and let's see about the next tool. Okay, the next tool is top. Okay, top is a very powerful tool for process monitoring, like PS. Let's see about top, how we can use it. As I told you before, process monitoring is very important to security. Imagine that malware analysts use process monitoring when they analyze malware, when they perform dynamic analysis of malware or evil code. So we need to think process monitoring as a very important task. So let's see about top. If you press top, you can see all the processes for the user root, for the user Kalima user. You can see the PID. As you saw in the previous command PS, you can see the CPU consumption, the memory consumption, the utilization. So what can we do? First of all, we can use many parameters, many keystrokes. First of all, we will try top u for user and our user, which is Kali. Okay, as you can see, every process right now is by the user Kali, not root. So it's a perfect example for monitoring all the specific processes. Okay, let's see something else. Let's go back to our top and let's use the Z option. If you press Z, you will see in color all the active processes. Okay, right now you can see all the running processes, so it's very useful. You can see all of them in red. We don't have any inactive. If we had any, the color would be white, so we are okay for now. Let's press Shift P to sort by the CPU utilization. Okay, as you can see, Shift P, here's the process with the most CPU utilization. Okay, 9.2 from the Xorg. Okay, another example is the output. So when you have to prepare a report for the process monitoring to give to a colleague or another user, you can use top me one for execution that will make one loop of the process searching, slash b, and output to a txt. Let's name it process report txt. Okay, if we cut it, I'm sorry. Okay, we have a report for all the processes. Okay, I think we are done with top. As we can see, PS and top is some very and powerful command line tools. Let's move on to htop. Htop is another powerful tool. It's like top, but it's a more interactive process monitoring tool. Let's see about this. I will change back to the Kali machine and let's type htop. Okay, as we can see, it is it has a very beautiful interface, even though it's not graphical, but it's a terminal text interface. Okay, we have many options. We have just to press F buttons. For example, let's press F5. We can see a tree like we saw on the PS command. with a forest parameter. Okay, it's very useful. Let's try F6. Okay, we can select which parameter we want to output first. Let's see about PID. Okay, we have the user root with PID 1 to set a process with PID 1272, and we have more below. Let's sort by another filter. We will use we should use about memory utilization. Okay, why not? Okay, so we can see that the memory section is in a blue color, the other ones is in green, so we can see the process with the most consumption with 2.3. Okay, as we can see, it is a very nice tool. You can press F9 to kill a process, but I do not want to kill a process, so I will press escape, okay, and quit with F10. Okay, as we can see, it is a very beautiful, very, very beautiful tool. Okay, I'm sorry. Nice, it's clear, and let's switch back to see what's next. Nice. Okay, the next one is the Enmon tool. Enmon is another impressive tool which we can use to monitor processes. So let's see about it. Okay, let's press Enmon. Okay, as we can see, there are many options that we can use. We can press C for the CPU, M for memory. We can see information about disks, information about kernel, about network. So let's see about CPU. Let's press C. Okay, we have some information about the CPU utilization. Okay, let's go back. Okay, and let's try VM for memory information. Okay, we can see many useful information about our RAM usage, about our swap space. Swap space is used when the RAM is full, so we have 100% free swap space. Okay, let's go back and see some other information. Enmon. Let's press R for the resource. Okay, why not? Okay, we can see the version of our Linux distribution. I have the 2020.3. Okay, very nice. And let's see another tool. BusStop. BusStop is another powerful tool. It's not like top and it's top, but it's quite a beautiful tool. Let's see about it. Okay, as you can see, it has a very impressive interface. You can see the CPU utilization. You can see your CPU information. I have Ryzen 7. It shows the memory utilization and the swap space again, and the processes. As you can see, I have many active processes. So it's quite beautiful. You can press K to kill a process. So I will not use it. I will not use it right now. Let's see another tool. Let's quit from here. Clear. Okay. The next one and the final one is glances. Glances is another valuable tool. Glances. Okay. Let's wait. Okay, we have many useful information. A more detailed CPU utilization and memory too. That's what is very important, and we need those information. We can see the read and the write speed about our file system or about our disk. We can see information about our network, but I have disconnected my virtual machine from the network. And finally, as the previous tools, you can see the active processes. As you can see, this changes over time, so it's an interactive tool. Okay, that's all about the process monitoring. Of course, there are many other beautiful tools, but those are my favorite ones that I use the most. And let's move on to another section. Okay, the next one is about managing Linux system services. Alright, what is a system service? System service is a software that runs in the background, so we can say that a system service is a non-interactive process. In addition, service carries out essential tasks of the operating system. To explain it more in depth, we need to know that the first process of the Linux operating system is the init process, which in turn starts all the system services. And how can we manage system services? There are two service managers. The first one is the systemd, and the second one is the sysvinit service manager. Let's see some examples. We will change back to the virtual machine. And first of all, we have to type sudo because we need root privileges, and then systemctl list units type equals service because we need services, and state equals active. Okay, as you can see, there are many units. We can see that they are loaded, they are active, and some are active, some are running, and some are exited. We need to know that it is not necessary for a service to be running. It is just started in the boot time, so it will be active but not necessary running. So can we list all the running services? Yes, of course we can. We can exit from here and change the state active to state equals running. Okay, we have only 19 running services. We can see the cron service. Cron is a service which executes shell script when we want, in a specific time. We can see the modem manager service. We can see the rsyslog, which is used about logs, and we can see many other services. and how we can list all the services with the SysVinit service manager. Let's clear the screen. We will type sudo because, as previous, we want root privileges, and we will type service status all. Okay. Right now, we can see all the services. Again, they have a minus symbol, which means that is closed, and we can see the plus symbol. That means that they already running as the systemd service manager. We can see that cron is running right now. We can see dbus running right now. So for example, let's open a service. Let's open Apache 2. Okay, sudo service. Sorry, Apache 2 start. And let's output, let's list the services status all. Okay, as we can see, Apache right now has a plus symbol. So how can we start Apache 2 at boot time? Because every time we boot the operating system, the services will be the same. Some will have the plus and some will have the minus symbol. Okay? To start a service at boot time, we just have to use the systemd service manager to systemctl enable Apache 2. Okay? Right now, if we restart the system, we will see the Apache 2 run. But it is not always security. It is not very secure to have a service running, because, for example, when we have Apache 2 running, we will have an open port. Okay, of course we can close it with a firewall, but again, we should know where and when we open a system service. One more time, let's list only the active services with SysVinit service manager. So we'll type service status all. And we can use grep, because grep is a powerful tool to output only the lines we want. So when we input something like plus, this command will output all the services that are running right now. As you can see, we have all the running services. If we stop the Apache and list all the running services, we will not see the Apache 2 because we have closed the service. Okay, that's all about the services. Let's move on to another section, which is a very important section. It's about managing Linux updates and packages. Okay, let's start with repositories. So what is a repo or a repository? A repository is a storage location where your operating system receives updates and applications. It's a server far from your computer. And when you update your system, your package manager receive all the application from the repositories. I'm sorry. Let's see about the repository categories. First of all, we have the stable repos. The stable repos are repositories which contain stable and tested software releases. The software usually have all the security fixes, have fixed bugs, and it's tested from bugs. So whenever the team says that the software is tested and fully stable, this software belongs to the stable repositories. For example, let's open up my terminal and let's cut my stable repos. Okay, here you can see the Debian Busters stable repos. My opinion is that the stable repos are very secure because they have stable software. You don't have to worry about security issues because the team behind the operating system can ensure that the software is almost 100% secure. So let's clear the screen and let's see what's next. We have the unstable repositories. The unstable repositories contain software that are in the latest update version. For example, if I have a software that is in version 1.1 and I include one bug fix, or I will include a new feature, I will update its version and I will include it to unstable repo. For example, an unstable repo is from CentOS here, repo list. Okay, here's the repos from CentOS 8, or we can see from the Kali machine that I have the unstable repos. It is very useful to have unstable repos, especially if you are a developer, because you can test the latest update of a software, of an application. But if you are system administrator or a system engineer, it is recommended that you use a stable repo. Okay, let's see what's next. We have the testing repositories. This kind of repos contain the upcoming version of a stable version. To explain it again, the test repo contains software, unstable software that are going to be included in the stable repos. For example, Debian Seed contains software that it will include it they include in the stable repos of the Debian's Bullseye, the upcoming 11 version. Okay. That's one of the useful features of the repositories. And let's go to the packages. You have to update your system every since and then. I recommend that an administrator should update his system every week or every 2 or 3 days. In CentOS, you can issue the YAM update and the package they want to install, or YAM check update. And in Debian systems, you should use sudo apt update. Okay, as you can see, I fetch all the updates from the repositories. Okay, as you can see, here are all the software and the applications, the libraries that are gonna be updated. Okay, this is very useful, and let's see what we have next. Okay, the next section is about system vulnerability scanning and auditing. First of all, what is a vulnerability? A vulnerability is a weakness or a flaw which can leave a system open to attack. There are the system and the software vulnerabilities. In many cases, vulnerability comes from a misconfigured software. So how can we resolve any vulnerability issues? Users and the system administrator have to patch their software to the latest update. If you see any announcement or an update that software has a vulnerability issue, and they have to update their systems properly. So this is very important, to update the system. And how can we scan the system for vulnerabilities? To scan for vulnerabilities, I'm sorry, in the rootkits, we have to use scanning and auditing tools. I have prepared some tools to show you. As you can see, here's Zenmap and Zenmap. Zenmap is the GUI version, the graphical user interface version of the Nmap. I have prepared the Arcade Hunter. Arcade Hunter is a tool to scan for rootkits, and Linis, which is an auditing tool for vulnerabilities. So let's start with Nmap. Nmap stands for the Network Mapper. It's a free and open source scanner licensed under GPL. It can be used for host discovery, port scanning, network service and version detection. This is a feature that we will go to use, and operating system detection. In addition, Nmap uses the NSC, Nmap security engine, scripting engine, which is a very useful and valuable feature. It gives us the option for service detection and operating system detection, and also for vulnerability detection. Here is the path of the script location, of the NSC script location. Let's switch back to the Kali machine, and let's scan for vulnerabilities and And let's scan the Nmap server, scanme.nmap.org. Okay, Nmap stands for script and for service version, and we will use the default version of the script. Let's start the scan. Let's wait to scan the scanme.nmap.org, It will take a while. Okay. As we can see, we have the open ports. We can see that the server that is hosted everything is Apache in the version 2.4.7. We can see that it contains the SSH service in the port 22, and the version is 6.6.1p1. To scan for vulnerabilities, as we can see, we have to open a browser and scan for vulnerabilities, or we can see about Searchploit. It is a very useful tool for scanning vulnerabilities. Let's see an example. We will use the Apache version to scan for vulnerabilities. And Apache, fine. We can see the versions. Okay. And we can see that we do not have any vulnerability here with the Apache, and its version shows you from ExploitDB database if you have any software misconfiguration. So that is a very useful tool if you combine it with the Nmap. So let's see what we got next. We have the Linus. Linus is another powerful tool for vulnerability scanning. Let's use it. Let's power off the. Okay. Sudo Linus audit system. But if you don't know which options you can provide, you can press the --help. You can always see which parameters can you use. Audit system, update. So it's the Linux version. I will use the audit system to show you how it can be used. Sudo Linux audit system. Okay. It detects the version of the kernel, the version of the hardware architecture. Okay. Let's let it to finish. It is very very powerful and helpful tool, because it suggests which software we can use to protect our system. Okay, as you can see, Telnet is an insecure service, so it cannot. It did not fund the service. Okay. As you can see, there are many features. Okay. What else? It checks if we have any database up and running, if we have any PHP service up and running. it tells you that if it found any vulnerabilities, if we have updated the system. So as you can see, it's a very powerful tool. Let's see another tool, which is ArcadeHunter. ArcadeHunter is an open source tool and a free open source tool that scans the system, the local system, for rootkits and backdoors. It is very powerful. Let's use it. First of all, we can see which options we can pass as arguments. Okay, we can use the update to update the database. We can press .c or .check to check the system for rootkits. So let's use this option, sudo arcadehunter .check. Okay. Okay, it scans all the user bin software to see if it finds any malicious software. We have a warning, but okay, it's very secure. Let's continue the scan. As you can see, it did not find any rootkit from the known ones. These are the known rootkits. As we can see, we are very secure. Just remember to execute once in a while to ensure that your system is up to date and secure. Okay, let's wait. It scans for kernel module names. If a kernel module is vulnerable or untrusted, it will tell us, it will output that warning. Okay, let's continue. It checks for open ports. Continue. Okay, as we can see, it checked the file system. Here's the var log. In the var log directory, the arcadehunter.log, it logs to the arcadehunter report, so we can read it anytime when we perform the scan, so we can be up to date with the most secure software and system. Let's see what we got next. The next section is about Linux pluggable authentication modules. Alright, let's begin. So, what is PAM? PAM, or Linux pluggable authentication modules, stands for a set of modules or for a set of libraries which are used to authenticate a Linux user to a system, service, or to some applications. There are four types of Linux PAM modules. The first one is the authentication management modules, which help in the user authentication. The second one is the password management modules, which help in updating a password. An example is the cracklib. We will see an example later. We'll show you a practical example. The third one is the season management modules, which help in to set up or to clean a service, or to set some process per user. We also see an example about this. And finally, we have the account management modules, which help about account verification. So let's see some examples. First of all, we will see about set up some process limits per user. So we'll type sudo nano. You can use any other text editor. You can use Vim, or you can use gedit, leafpad. There are many other options. Etc. Security. This is the directory of the PAM limits resource file, and limits conf. Okay. Here you can see some comments, what we can use to enable the module domain. You can see what is the domain. The name can be a group name, can be a username. The type could be soft or hard. Sorry. So what is soft and what is the hard limits? Soft are the limits that a normal user can change that later, and the hard limit are the limits which can only be changed by the root user. Item, you can use the core, the data, the CPU, then proc. This is the example I will use, then proc, and the value is an integer number of how many processes will be used by specific user. So let's give an example. Let's go down here, or let's get here. We will set process limits about my user Kali. Type will be hard, so only root user can change that later. Item will be a proc. I will limit the process for this user. This will enhance the security level, and the value will be let's set to 100 or 50. Let's set it to 75. Okay. Let's save it, and now we managed to set some limits for our user Kali. Another example is the password. So we can ensure that the user will set strong passwords, and the system will not allow him to set some weak or some weak password. So let's clear the screen. Sudo nano etc pamd / common password. Okay. We will change this line. First of all, let's explain what is this. We will require requisite password. Here is the library, the SERI object. Here is the retry for the max password the system will ask the user to prompt the password 3 times before sending an error. The mean length of the password is the set is the size of the password. Defog is the number of the character changes in the new password that differentiates it from the old password. So let's change it. We will set retry from 34. We will change from minimum length from 8 to 18. Why not? As we said before, we need to set a passphrase instead of a password. Defog will let it 3. It's not a problem. You can set UCredit. UCredit stands for uppercase letters. Let's set it to 3. LCredit, let's set it to 4 or to 5. LCredit is a lowercase characters. Decredit, let's put it to to 8. This stands for digit in the password. And let's set the credit, which set for the symbol in the password, and let's set it to 5. Okay, we have 3 plus 5 plus 8 plus 5, it's 10, 18, 21. So let's decrease it. Okay, we have 16. Okay, we have 5. Yeah. Now we have the minimum length 18. Let's save it. So we set the digits, the lowercase, the uppercase, and the symbols. Okay, let's exit and let's change the password. I will press 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Okay. We can see that the password is way too short and the password is too little, so our module is working. So we are everything is under control by this module. Let's clear the screen and see what's next. Okay, the next one is the next one season is its section is the bus scripting. So bus scripting, it is used for automation. We will use the bus scripting language. It is not a programming language, but it's a set of tools which helps to automate tasks. So before we automate something, we need to ask some questions. The first one is, what does automation mean? Automation means something that we do not have to input data every time. So we need to write a script where in turn we'll execute after the software execution. The second question is, which tools will be used to achieve automation? We will use many tools, many graphical, many text mode tools. We can use text editing like grep, to pattern files, to pattern output. We can use awk and many other commands, built-in commands. And the third question is the process truly automated? If we have managed to reduce the input from the software, so an application or a software executes with, for example, one input, we have managed to successfully automate it. Okay, so let's see some examples of automation with bus scripting language. Okay, the first one is the backup. Backup is a very important process. It helps you to save your data, your important files and the data to an external location, to another hard drive or to a USB stick. It is very important because in case of system corruption, you can always have a copy of the files that you do not want to lose in any case. So as you can see here, I have an image right here, which I use tar to bundle and compress all the files in this directory. So I will use tar to bundle everything into a single file name called backup -dir.tar.gunzip. And in the following output of ls, you can see the backup into a tarball, into a tar file, which contains every file from A to J. I have prepared some examples for you. We will switch to CentOS 8 in the virtual machine, so I can show you the scripts. I can show you how to automate the backup process. It is a very basic and useful script. I will explain every line right now. Okay, let's start with the backup script. Let's use Vim. All right. And let's open another window. Let's remove the directory to create something else. But let's change to this directory. I have prepared two files, but we will create another two files. I have created the email txt that inside contains a random fake email, and I have created the password txt, which contains a random password. So we will create a phone txt which contains some important contacts, so I will append the name John to phone txt. I will append his phone, so it will be 690 okay, to the phone txt. Let's output this text file. Okay, as you can see, we have contact John with his phone. So right now, we do not want in any case to lose those three files. So in case of data corruption or system corruption, we will have to an external location those three files. So let's see the process of the backup. First of all, I have created a variable which contains the date into a txt. So let's see another example. If I press date, I'm sorry. Okay, you can see that today is Saturday, October 10th of October, and my time, and my time zone, and the year. Okay, so we want to save the backup with a special name, because we will automate this process, so we want a specific file name for this one. So we will name it as backup dash and the date, but we want the first three columns, the Saturday, the October, and the 10th of October. You can use whatever you want. You can use only the month, you can use the month and the number of the month, the day, or you can use only the day. So we'll show you how to make it to do this. The second variable is the oc, which will print the first column, the second column, and the third column of this file. So let's I will show you an example. So date to date txt, cut date txt, and we have the full date. Now we will oak the output, so we will keep the Saturday, the October and 10th with oak. Oak is a tool that helps to output specific patterns in a file. So oak, this is its syntax, print, and if we want to print the Saturday, I will type $1 for column 1. The second column, which is October, we will print it as $2, and the 10th with $3. You can use only the month and the days, as I mentioned before, so you can use these. But I will use the Saturday, so I will use $1, 2, and 3. Okay? And I will specify the file name. As you can see, we have only the Saturday, the October, and the 10th. Okay, undoubtedly, you can use the date command. You can use its the command's parameters, the options, but I use oc. I find it more useful. So instead of spaces, we want to print dashes, so we will use tr. Tr is a command line tool which helps to replace content inside the line. So in the above example, we will use tr, double quotes, space, so we will replace space with double quotes, dash, double quotes. Okay, as you can see right now, we have Saturday dash October dash 10th, and we have the tr command, which will verbose the output, will verbose which files will be archived, will be bundled into the tarball, into the tar file. First of all, we specify the file name, so it will be backup dash brackets and the name here, so because we will take it as a variable. This variable equals to the output of this command, so it will be this output. So when we want an output of a command to be appended to a line or to a variable, we can use dollar and parentheses, and inside we can execute whatever we want. And as the second parameter, we will use our directory, or our home directory, or another directory in our file system like var or opt. You can use whatever directory you want to bundle and compress. I used this dir because we want to bundle the email, the password, and the phone.txt file. Let's remove the date. Okay, and afterwards I remove the date.txt because we do not want to save the date again and again. So let's we have the backup script. Okay, as you can see, I have many outputs, I have many files, two files, okay, with backup of this directory. Let's remove the first one. Let's remove this directory. As you can see, I do not have the directory dir. So let's extract with xf to extract the file. Okay, as you can see, there is the directory dir. Okay, and inside we have the email txt, the password txt, and the phone txt as well. This was the first example. Let's clear the screen, or okay, let's I'm sorry, clear. And the second example, which is very useful in this, is the nmap script. So as you saw earlier in the vulnerability auditing and scanning section, I used nmap with NSE, with nmap scripting engine, to scan a server for services, for open services, and the version of the services. So we could automate this process. We do not have to type nmap -svac script default and the server IP every time. So let's see how we can automate the process. Okay, here is the script. As you can see here, I have some variables, a read command. This script can be used in two ways. The first one is to read the user's input. It will prompt this question: please insert your server's IP, and the user has to input the server IP or the domain. You can use whatever you want. And afterwards, it takes this variable input and will output it to the nmap command, nmap scanning command, and will save it as a report. You can use the previous way to save the report with a date, but to show you, I will keep it as simple as possible. So let's save it. Okay, let's execute the script. Please insert your server's IP. I will use the domain which I used earlier. Scan me to tenmap.org. And we hope to see the safety report in many formats. We will see it when the script will finish. Let's give it some time to finish. Okay. The script is finished. We have many report files. Let's cut one of them. It's the same output. So the first way of the nmap usage, nmap scanning script usage, is successful. Let's clear the screen. Let's remove every report file and let's see it again. The second way is more is easier. As you can see, I have prepared a variable which name is server IP equals to something, so you can change it statically, and this variable value will be outputted to the nmap command. So let's run it. As we can see, the previous example was interactive, so as you can see now, this script is non-interactive. You can statically set the value to the server IP and it will scan it and will be automate the scan. Okay, fine. We have the same output. And let's see the report. It's the same. So we are good to go. We have managed to create the scripts. Let's remove them. Let's clear the screen. And I will show you a very important and interesting way to automate your scripts. Every now and then you can use this way that I will show you to automate your scripts every day, every hour, every specific day of the month or of the week. So let's see about it. It's a Chrome, as you know, as if you don't know, Chrome is a utility that schedules tasks. It schedules jobs to run at a specific time. The Chrome format is very simple. First of all, we have an asterisk for the minute, which is from 0 to 59 for hours, for the day, 7 days, the 31 days of the month, I'm sorry, 31 days, 12 months, day of the week, and secondly, we specify the path where our script belongs, and we can use a command or we can use a script, we can use whatever we want, a script or a command or anything else that can be executed. And to make this done, we can use crondab-e. I will show you right now. Crondab-e. Okay, I have prepared this crondab, this cron. I have input some script execution. The first one is that it will be executed every 9th of the month. I can change it, so we can execute this script every 10th of the month or 11th. When you have to change a value from this side to this side, you can use zeros until you will set an input right here. So if we had to change the month, if we had to change to make executions every April, we had to use 0, 0, 0 and 4. Okay, it's very simple and easy. And the second example, it's that the execute, that the script, but the backup script will execute, will be executed every hour, or will be executed hourly. And the nmap script will be executed every 11th of the month. Okay, that's all about the Chrome. You can provide something else. We can make some other execution every 15th of the month, and usr bin top to report top txt. Right now, as you can see, every 15th of the month, it will be generated the processes of the current cell to a report-top.txt file. Okay, that's all about the Chrome. That was the end of the presentation. Thank you very much. I really hope you have enjoyed this section. I really wish you have many questions that I can help you, and you found it very useful and important, because security has a big role in Linux administration. And security and administration in general. So if you have any questions, you can directly ask them to me, or you can use my email panoskalarog@gmail.com, and I will answer you as soon as possible. Thank you very much again. Bye.